in the GSL Codex. All right, in the bottom left starting location. He cheesed in that game. I have no idea what he's going to do this game, but he's in the lead. He is...
Bjorn Prang.
And in the upper right, a three-time GSL champion, formerly the best Zerg in the world, here to win another GSL. Let's see if he can get past Bjorn, though. He is...
LJM Nasty.
Right, so Tasteless.
Yeah.
The most expensive area of Korea called Gangnam.
Yes, Gangnam. I used to live there, yeah.
Me too. It was really expensive.
It was really expensive. I moved out.
You know, Nasty and the owner of Samsung Electronics, the biggest company in Korea, each own a floating castle over Gangnam.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, no, it's like one of those medieval
England
castles.
He's got like a rope. He's got to climb up to get up there.
Well, Nasty just can jump up. But the owner of Samsung, he has to take his helicopter. Now, I mean, this is a floating castle made out of rocks and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, it is actually, it weighs so much. Like, Nasty was going to put a pyramid in, but there was, like, too much sand. You don't want to get sand and everything, so you just use that. Now, I mean, that is... quite an expensive house, man, but this guy has won that much money.
Yeah, they both got cannons pointed at each other from their separate castles.
Oh, you better believe that, Tasteless. Cannonballs are the only way to fight against a castle. Are you kidding me?
Yeah. Any other way is just not civilized.
No. Missiles?
No.
What? No.
Which game had the floating castle? Was that Final Fantasy VI?
That was the game of life in Korea, Tasteless.
I'm
I don't
sorry.
Know what you're talking about.
Wait a minute.
Oh, Final Fantasy 3. Oh, yeah, you call it 6 because you're a hipster.
I am a hipster.
Sup, hipster?
It's the sixth one,
Tasteless, why don't you show yourself out, you hipster nerd?
Well, hold on. I can't find the door unless I put my glasses on that don't have lenses. So. All right. It's the third hatch you're going down here.
It's a very quick third hatch. And that's something Nest T actually does a lot more than other people. And, in fact, it's before any pool.
It's before the pool. Yeah, I was about to say. I don't see a pool on the minimap.
Well, you know, that's the trick of what he's done here with this quick drone scout. And this is something Symbol's been doing, too. And I think I've seen DRG do it a little bit. Where you scout quickly with the drone. You see command center first because it's so popular right now against Zerg. You say, well, I can just get two hatches out of this. And that's going to put Zerg in a great spot. And what that's going to force... is for Ghost King to either Bjorn to either go ahead and go for a timing attack to try to really hurt Nasty, to try to maim him, or he's going to have to go for the third command center and a couple engineering bays. Otherwise, Nasty's just going to get ahead. But at the same time, Nasty can mix in things like roach rushes and stuff. So it's a complicated game. It's like the politics in Game of Thrones. It's like you really have to try to think what's in the other person's head, what they're doing, what their thoughts are on it, and you have to play accordingly.
I think it's very well said, Artosis.
Yeah, and ST is the Tyrion of this world.
Is he Tyrion?
Are you kidding me? He's the best at the game.
I think he gets to be Tyrion and the dragon.
He's all three
of the dragons and Tyrion. And I have a theory that Jon Snow will be a badass by the end of that, so maybe...
he's Jon Snow as
maybe
well.
Jon Snow. Maybe he's actually the guy that controls that kingdom north of the wall.
He's like every character that... Yeah. You No, he's not that guy. No. He runs everything.
He's Khaleesi, too. It's like, settle down, man. He can't get to everybody.
He's Joffrey, man. Whoever's the current king, he's that person.
He's Joffrey right now?
Yeah, he's Joffrey right now. Yeah.
All right.
What do you have to say about that?
Nothing. Right. Well, I already know I'm going to try to trash on Joffrey, and you're going to be like, listen, man, it's not easy being a king.
No, man, it's not.
Hey, man, it's tough.
You act as if it's easy, Tasteless. All right, so Nest T right now is going up to six queens, which is a really powerful style
now. This is new stuff since the patch.
Yeah, and six queen style is amazingly, amazingly good.
Now,
you get your creep out so far, and you don't have to get your gas for so long that it powers you up to an unbelievably high level. Now, with Bjorn, he's going for Banshee Hellion, which... can do all right against this. It's a good way to try to control creep. He's probably going to want to get a Raven out as well. And we'll have to see if he actually wants to go ahead and do that. He'll get the Banshees first for sure.
I feel like the Banshee play nowadays with the 6-queen openings, or even the 5-queen openings, I feel like it's just not going to be as effective anymore.
Well, you know what? I like it still, because when you pair it with Hellions and you get the Raven, like you have two Banshees, a Raven, and a bunch of Hellions, I feel like that's enough to control the map against 6-queen.
Do you feel like, though, when you do builds like this one, by the way, double Evo Chamber going down, and he's actually taken up 4 gases at once.
Mm-hmm.
Do you feel like, though, because you're spending all your factory energy, the amount, their output, I guess you could say, on Hellions, then your siege tank count is going to be so low when you have to do the Marine siege tank push that if Zerg's not hurt early on, they actually just get this massive lead. They just make Banelings, and you can't actually punish them?
That's a very good point. And, in fact, that's something that we do see out of players quite often in this. And hold on, we have some Hellion harassment coming into the third base. Getting a few drones so far. Looks about 5 died. And, in fact, even more going to go down. Nesty not quite ready for this harassment. Bjorn doing a great job so far.
Yeah, he got every single drone here.
He's getting all the Zerglings as well. Bjorn really bringing it to Nesty so far.
All right, the Banshee's coming in here. A great addition to this already Hellion.
Whoa, 13 workers killed.
Oh, God, I didn't realize it was that many.
Yeah, it didn't look like that many. That was craziness.
All right, and he's got to be careful. He's got to stay not out of range, not just out of range of that Spore Crawler, but out of vision as well. Zerglings, by the way, are hitting the third base of Bjorn made. Bjorn getting a little bit greedy here, building that base in low ground, but he will not have a forced cancel.
Nesty still has not started his lair, okay? And he hasn't started upgrades on his Evos either. And he has, like, 500 gas just now starting all that. So he was a little bit behind on everything. He really got thrown off here. And, I mean, Bjorn's doing a great job as is.
All right. Banshee's getting pretty low. It's pretty long distance to go back and extra repair. The second Banshee not really used over here.
Yeah, not quite yet.
I have to say, the Hellions are not doing a good job of actually denying creep. You know what I mean? The creep's actually out there despite...
They're having a hard time of it for sure. But you know what? He's getting another Banshee, and he can do a couple scans. It's actually worth it to push the creep way back if he can. Now, the Hellions still are pushing around, going after this queen right now. Killing any queens he can is pretty huge. Speed not even close to done. So another queen does go down here. And Bjorn is just really, really playing superbly here.
What is his stat here? 7 times. Oh, I see when he goes Banshee, he wins 5 games out of 2. So
five
far.
5 games out of 2. That's sick, man.
That's actually a pretty good.
That's like 250% of the games played.
Spire, by the way, going down now for Nesty. Now, I have to say, Nesty's actually taken a lot of damage. This is not the Nesty I'm used to casting.
No, Nesty is the guy that, like, remember when MMA was the best TVZer in the world and Nesty didn't lose a single drone to, like, 10 minutes of harassment?
Yeah, I remember that. That's actually insane. That's an Nesty I'm used to casting, but...
Well, Nesty has to mix it up, man, or we get bored, so we'll see what he wants to do here to come back.
All right, here come the Hellions now. And there's a lot of drones. This is a pretty saturated little area here. Now, he's stuck over. He may just try to shoot down the drones no matter what.
And he gets them all. Well done by Nesty.
I got to say, I really was expecting Bjorn to actually target down the drones there, not the Zerglings, since he was obviously going to lose those Hellions no matter what.
Yeah, that's true. I guess he wanted to reduce the numbers a little bit. You know, it is that attack you were talking about, once you hit 2-2 and you get Baneling speed, it's so scary, the Mass Ling Baneling style. And we've seen specifically even Nesty do that. And I believe we actually saw him do it on this map as well. So that's something Bjorn has to keep in mind. So reducing Zergling count, I kind of understand it. He is going into siege tanks now at this point, but he only has 1 out so far. So he is going to be a little low on that.
All right. So we got the Banshees out here. I don't know what it is. I always kind of expected him to not get that deep in GSL Code S. He's playing really, really well.
Yeah, well, he's actually an extremely good Terran.
He's a really talented guy.
Marine King said it like a couple seasons ago on GSL. He's like, yeah, Bjorn's one of the reasons why we're going to win.
Yeah.
And then they did win. I don't think Bjorn was having anything to do with that. I think that was more, you know, a computer crashing and parting and losing to Marine King. But
no, but seriously, he actually is really good. All right, by the way, Cloak Banshee's now spotted here. Oh, nice. He's going to be able to gun down the queen and take out the Overseer.
Yeah, very nicely done. I like that Viking being out here helping out with that. In fact, he's going to take
actually,
out
I really
more.
Like this. Yeah, you know, just use the Banshees to clean up the creep.
No, he's doing so much,
oh,
man.
Now we got Muta's over here. Is the base Muta proofed? It looks like it is. You know,
yeah.
Bjorn has not missed a beat here. In fact,
no,
he has a lead in supply, which is not the way it's supposed to look number-wise in a ZBT. Normally, the Zerg in StarCraft 2 always gets maxed out, before. So he's going to come over here and try to take out these Banshees.
But does he have any detectors in the region? No,
well,
he
he's got a Spore Crawler just out of vision. Whoa, just out of vision there.
Yeah, and that's
he's
going
to force a cancel.
Yeah, that's powerful Banshee play right there.
Damn, did you see that targeting?
Oh, my God.
Whoa. Okay, he forced a cancel. Anesti is a wreck, man.
Yeah, he's having about the hardest time we've ever seen him have.
It's pretty easy to avoid the Overseer with the Banshees. The Overseer is not exactly the most mobile unit. But one of those Banshees is out of energy. By the way, we got a lot of upgrades here coming from Bjorn. Now, Bjorn's going to push out. Now, the real question is, are there going to be any good Baneling connects here? Because if he takes out this base over here, I think Nesti might actually lose. You can't be on three base. It's a three base Terran. You just can't do it. It's not the way the Zerg operates.
And
one good thing going for Nesti. Yeah. Runs right into that medevac. Well, and now he's going to counter over here to the third base.
Well, he's definitely going to lose that one base of his, but can he actually kill off the command center? A lot of Mutas are actually attacking it right now.
Yeah, he's going to get it for sure. But here's the other thing is that it's going to be two base Zerg versus two base Terran now.
Oh, God.
Take out
right.
His third. So if I were Bjorn, I would actually pack my bags and go home now.
Yeah, he needs to actually get home with that army. That army is not as big as it could be. In fact, Nesti has so many units right now that I feel like Nesti, if he flanks it, he can crush that army, but
well,
he needs to flank it.
Even if he turns around, he might get squashed here. Maybe he should hold position out here and try to send over his army again.
He's on creep. He actually needs to scan and get rid of creep tumors. In fact,
he just did
that because if Nesti sees when he unsieges and moves, he'll kill that army for sure.
I was about to say, if he sees the army going back, Siege Tanks will be in siege mode, can't combat Banelings, he'll just turn around.
In fact, he might just kill it anyway as he has so many Mutas. That's actually insane, man. He's got 22 Mutas with plus one right now. That is like a really fearsome force.
Also note that Bjorn is maxed out. It looks like Bjorn actually wanted to just use his... Okay, I see what he's doing now. He has this army here to make sure Nesti can't get a third in that convenient location. Meanwhile, the rest of his army is defending back at home. He's willing to lose this army at the top as long as Nesti gets an expansion later, and that's exactly what's going to happen.
Well, Nesti
does
crush that army.
Strategic, so he crushes it, but Bjorn's fine with that because Bjorn can remake. Look at the supply. 174 to 151. Nesti with no operating third or fourth base. He has them building.
Yeah.
And I think all Bjorn's going to do is try to secure his third base, probably push it again, and I think Nesti will probably lose if I'm analyzing this correctly.
Well, you know, Nesti, he has a lot of minerals banked up. He's making a lot of hatcheries. He still has shot here. A lot of it is based upon these siege tanks. You know, the siege tanks are really what's going to keep Bjorn alive because Nesti does have a lot of lings and a lot of banelings. So that's really important. And I love that Bjorn's getting two Thors right now. That is so important because there is such a gigantic Mutalisk flock still.
All right. Now, you can see with the sensor tower up, this makes it pretty inconvenient for Nesti. There's no real element of surprise there. In fact, he scans that big boulder. I don't really think he should have kept his Zerglings right in range of that. Because he just scans his, okay, is that how many Banelings you have?
Oh, my God! Oh, that was a nice move by Bjorn.
Oh!
They aren't afraid of Banelings at all.
No, I know. It looks like he's going to send a small group of Marines up here. Probably wait for that hatchery to finish and stem and attack it. Probably at the same time, it looks like Bjorn's probably going to make a sweeping motion.
Yeah.
Actually, do a vision check, Artosis. Does he see the bottom right expansion for
Nesti? He has no idea.
He has no clue.
Although,
it's going to be almost impossible to get drones there. Hold on. Top center. Notice he's scanning for Baneling landmines. Bjorn is good.
Yeah,
is he going to get the hatchery?
Right.
No.
That's gone, but is an next attack. Tasis is doing a good job. The Marines running forward, targeting down this very, very important new third. And can Nesti actually come down? He's actually looking like he's going for a counter.
All right, Nesti gathered up over here. He's in the center tower range now. Siege up the siege tanks, but that's a lot of Banelings.
That is a ton of
Banelings. But the Thors are coming up, and they can actually combat the Mutalisks just fine. Whoa!
Huge volleys.
Massively bruising those Mutas.
Those Thors just killed six Mutas right there and damaged the rest.
It's down to eight Mutas. Remember we had
God.
Like 23 earlier?
Yeah, it's
way lower now.
I mean, Nesti is in so much trouble. He doesn't really have anything going for him at this point. He's got a terrible economy, very low unit count. His upgrades are not keeping up with Bjorn's. Bjorn is just... playing so well, man. It's actually surprising how well he's playing. We knew he was good, but this is amazing.
All right, he's going to get the siege tanks, but as long as he can just keep the Marines alive here. No, he cannot. So see, if he has enough Marines alive, he can shoot down the rest of the Yudas and then actually continue to push out. Now, take a look at the supplies here. It's 167 to 109. Now, I want to point out Nesty is doing an insane job considering he has less supply than a Terran who is attacking the swell. And now he's going to snipe the hatch.
Oh,
Artosis,
man.
I don't think Nesty is going to win this round either.
No, this is looking bad, man. It looks like he's...
Oh, serious?
My God, 12
points.
Well, he's got a queen there that can actually transfuse three times. He should do that. He really needs to, in fact, because Bjorn's going to send something else
up
there. Yeah, I know. There's just not a question about that.
Note how Bjorn is constantly scanning. Actually, do a mineral check for the third base for Bjorn Artosis. How's he doing?
Plenty of minerals at
his
third.
So he's not going to mine out, so we don't need to worry about that.
And Nesty really hasn't been mining from the bottom right. He just sent a huge pack of drones
there. I think he was afraid because if he moves his drones out and they get shot down, this game's over. So
definitely.
He still has that hidden base. But Bjorn is probably going to try to expand there soon. That's actually smart by Nesty to mine that out as fast as he can.
Mm-hmm. I wish Nesty would transfuse that hatch a couple times. I'm, like, so nervous about it. We have two Marines that are walking around the map to try to snipe it. The thing is, they'll probably be able to do it, too. You have to react really quickly. And here we go! A Tunnelings and Banelings come in. He's got to focus these Banelings going after the Marines, but the Siege Tank's targeting them down very well so far. Still way too many Banelings left over, and the Siege Tank count is down to one.
All right, he's spreading really nicely here, though. It's making these Banelings not exactly cost-efficient.
Yeah, and they did hit Siege Tanks as well, and in fact, one
he's
Marine
come down
ends up
to actually
Marines
two Marines
in.
Left. They're like, all right, I'm going to go home. I lost everybody I ever knew.
And he sniped the hatch during that, too, by the way. Those two Marines walking around, they did their dirty work, Tasteless. So Nesty is only mining from the bottom right. And see that? He's shaking his hand.
He's getting stressed out. He's Bjorn's actually like drinking water. He's playing with a Rubik's Cube. He's doing Cat's Cradle. I'm like, wow, Bjorn.
Yeah, Bjorn's got it from here. Like, the production tab can really tell the story very well. Three infestors and a drone on the way. Not even a hatchery. I don't even know what his plan is from here. He's long-distance mining. I mean,
Bjorn's
he's not going to give up,
creep
but...
here. Wow.
Bjorn
is actually looking terrifying. You know, it's so funny. If we, like, covered up the names, and, obviously we didn't see who was in the booth, I would never have guessed this is an SD plane. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I just...
Well, you know what? Bjorn is actually playing so well that I think it's making Nesty look worse than he actually looks.
Bjorn looks like MMA or something right now, like when I'm watching this.
He looks better than that right now, to be honest.
Actually, that's true, yeah.
He looks like one of the absolute best Terrans that you could ever really see.
It looks like Bjorn's actually just trying to starve him out because Bjorn does not know... Wait a minute. He has a sensor tower. Does he... you're kidding me. Does he not know? Still know about the bottom right?
No
guys,
idea.
look at the mini-map. The sensor tower is just out of range of actually seeing that hatchery.
Yeah.
And had he made that a few hexes over, he would have gone and killed it. This game would be over, but that's Nesty's last hope.
That is. Well, he's down to 99 supply against a max Terran with better upgrades, Stasis. I don't know if that hope will be enough. In fact, I know for a fact it will not be enough.
No, it looks like he's just... Even though he never finds out about this bottom right base. Whoa, really nice fungals.
Oh, my God. That went as well as it could.
And Bjorn still wins.
Yep.
I think we're going to have a GG pretty soon here, guys.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he doesn't have any units left. He's making some more infestors. It's not going to be enough at all. And Nesty is against the ropes, Stasis.
Nesty's going to have to come back 3-0 like C did yesterday. GG.
Yeah. That's what IM players do, I guess.
Man, I can't believe Bjorn is up 2-0.
Guys, this is bad news for Nesty. I have to ask the whole universe, like Goku once had to do.
Yes.
Lend Nesty your power for the Spirit Bomb, because that's the only way to take out Bjorn right now.
This is like Peter Pan, where you have to believe in fairies. You ever see that play or whatever?
I didn't.
They're like, clap your hands if you believe in fairies. I'm like a little kid, I'm like, clap my hands, because I thought the fairies were going to die. It's actually messed up.
Whoa, you're such a tool. Child Tasis is such a tool. Oh, my God. I wish I could go back in time and never meet you. You're such a tool.
I love to see baby Artosis like playing with his toys. He's like, the top end goes on the bottom end. Like, I'm like, no, Artosis is like, the bottom end goes on the middle end. I'm like, oh, baby Artosis. No, but seriously, Nesty is
baby Artosis, Tasteless, lived in a house that had something that looked like a chimney, but it went into the furnace. So when he learned about Santa Claus and he walked downstairs, he was like,
do you ever have that one kid in school that, like,
everybody like realized Santa Claus wasn't real, but like there was that one kid whose parents like didn't tell
you're
him until like
say that, man.
Sixth
Some
grade.
People watch this with their kids.
If you have kids that are in there, tell them not to listen to that last thing I just said.
Of course. Yeah. Wasn't me.
There's some guys like still in middle school. He's like, "What is Taysom talking about?" guys, Nest T is not doing well.
No,
so shocked. I thought Bjorn would take some games off. I'm sure. But Nest T is just,
well,
really.
Bjorn's playing so well. Nest T needs to pick
brilliantly.
It up. The last two maps I really feel are better for Nest T.
Yeah.
Can he get through this next map, though? It's Entombed.
I don't know. Entombed was the map that I was saying might be the hard one for
him. I think this is one of the two hard ones for him, really.
Yeah, I think so. Guys, we're going to take a quick five-minute break. We come back, we're going to go to game three. But on that break, actually, you should check out the YouTube video of Bjorn's puppy.
Yeah.
I think it's GSTL. Just type in GSTL Bjorn puppy or something like that.
Something like that.
So stay tuned. We'll be back here with more Stark F2 action at the GSL Code S.
여러분은 지금 정우성과 함께 글로벌 스탠다드 GSA를 시청하고 계십니다.
이정범! 자, 한 가지 타기를 하게 됐고 한번 시작 승기가 좀 외롭게 승리를 하게 되지! 안 돼, 안 돼 이겁니다!
선수군요! 나 박수호 선수가 준비를 하는데요!
예, 아, 동네구라는 아이디로 레더에서 1위까지.
다른 분 다!
지금 너무 신나는 저글링의 춤이죠.
물밖에 없다니 이번 기억
제게 한다.
참 예선 이런 것도 못 들고 공식전 여기서 또 처음인데 앞으로 또 더 많이 활약할 거니까요. 예, GSTL이든 GSL이든 저 많이 주목해 주세요.
네.
핵심 주자로 원탑으로 가는 그 길을 박소호가 열었습니다.